Hi students, in this session we will prove Cauchy's second theorem on limits. We will discuss the converse of Cauchy's second theorem on limits and we will solve some problems on Cauchy's second theorem on limits. Cauchy's second theorem on limits. The statement says that if a sequence an is such that an is greater than 0 for all n belong to n and limit of an by an minus 1 as n tends to infinity is L, then limit of an to the power 1 by n as n tends to infinity is L. We know that the converse of Cauchy's first theorem on limit is not true in general, but the converse of Cauchy's first theorem on limit is true whenever the every term of the sequence, each and every term of the sequence is positive. That is, the converse of Cauchy's first theorem on limits is true if an is greater than 0 for all n belong to n. If you look at the statement, the first hypothesis is an is greater than 0 for all n belong to n. And hence, to prove Cauchy's second theorem on limits, we are going to use the converse of Cauchy's first theorem on limits. The statement of Cauchy's second theorem is, if a sequence an is such that an is greater than 0 for all n belong to n, that is, each and every term of the sequence is positive and limit of an by an minus 1 as n tends to infinity is L. That is, any two successive terms of the sequence converges to L. Then, limit of an to the power 1 by n as n tends to infinity is L. That is, the nth root of the sequence an is also converges to L. This is the statement of Cauchy's second theorem on limits. It has two hypotheses. First one is every term of the sequence is positive. Second one is the limit of any two successive term of the sequence is L. Then the sequence, nth root of the sequence converges to L. Now, we will consider the nth root of an. How we are going to write nth root of an? We are going to write the nth root of an, that is an to the power 1 by n, as a1 by 1, a2 by a1, a3 by a2, so on an by an minus 1 to the power 1 by n. Because a1 get cancelled, a2 get cancelled, similarly a3 get cancelled, that is every factor gets cancelled except an. That is, we will be left with an by 1. An by 1 is nothing but an. Therefore, we can write an to the power 1 by n as the product of n factors, namely a1 by 1, a2 by a1, a3 by a2, so on an by an minus 1 to the power 1 by n. Both are equal. Left side is equal to right hand side. Whenever we have a power, to simplify it, normally we take logarithm. Therefore, take logarithm on both sides. The base must be e. The base is always e in calculus. So log of an to the power 1 by n is equals to log of a1 by 1, a2 by a1, a3 by a2, so on an by an minus 1 to the power 1 by n. Now we are going to use some of the results on logarithm. Now, the above step is written as 1 by n. How we are really going to write this? Because we use the results of logarithms. The first result is power rule. What's the power rule says? Log of m to the power p to the base e becomes p into log m to the base e. That is, the power becomes the product. The product rule is log of m n to the base e equals to log m to the base e plus log n to the base e. That is, here the product becomes sum. We know that the value of the power is much easier than product of two numbers. 2 to the power 10 is much easier than 2 into 10. Similarly here, 50 into 100, m into n, if you take m is 50, n is 100, which is easier? 50 into 100 or 50 plus 100? 50 plus 100 is easy. Therefore, the logarithm changes the power into product, multiplication into addition. Now, using these two rules, the second step is rewritten as 1 by n. That is, the power becomes the product. 1 by n. Log of, we have a n products here. There are n products. The n product becomes now sum of n terms. So when you apply log, the product rule, log of a1 by a1 by 1, a2 by a1, a3 by a2, so on, an by an minus 1 becomes log of a1 by 1 plus, the product becomes sum now, plus log of a2 by a1 plus log of a3 by a2, so on, plus log of an by an minus 1. And this step is rewritten as this way. Log of a1 by 1 plus a2 by a1 plus log of an by n minus 1 by n. Now this is look like a1 plus a2 plus a3, so on, an by n. That is arithmetic mean of n terms. This is the one arithmetic mean of n terms. Now taking limit on both sides, because we want to find limit of nth root of an, right? Therefore, taking limit on both sides, we get limit of log an to the power 1 by n as n tends to infinity is equal to log of n tends to infinity into log of a1 by 1 plus log of a2 by a1 plus so on plus log an by an minus 1 whole divided by n. Now this is, as I told you, this is of the form log of a1 plus a2 plus a3 plus so on an by n. That is arithmetic mean of n terms. What is the Cauchy's first theorem? Cauchy's first theorem says that if limit of an to the base n tends to infinity is L, then the arithmetic mean also converges to L. That is, if an converges to L, the arithmetic mean of first n term also converges to L. That is a statement. But what's the converse? The reverse process. The reverse process. Therefore, the converse of Cauchy's first theorem is this. Limit of a1 plus a2 plus so on an by n as n tends to infinity is L. Then limit of an as n tends to infinity is L. Now look at this. This is nothing but this is looks like limit of a1. What is a1? This is a1 here. Plus a2. This is a2. Plus so on. Plus an. What is an? This is an by n. Therefore, since an is greater than 0 for all n belong to n in second theorem on limits. That is the first hypothesis. Therefore, the converse of Cauchy theorem can be applied here. And hence, the limit of this is exactly same as, look at this, limit of this arithmetic mean is exactly same as the limit of nth term. What's the nth term? This is the nth term. That is the nth term. Therefore, the next step, we will write limit of log of an by an minus 1. This is by converse of Cauchy's first theorem on limit. Now taking log on both sides, outside, take log outside, log of limit an to the power 1 by n as n tends to infinity is equals to log of limit of an by an minus 1 as n tends to infinity. We know that the second hypothesis of Cauchy's second theorem on limit is limit of n tends to infinity an by an minus 1 is L. An by an minus 1 is L. Therefore, now we can replace limit of an by an minus 1 as n tends to infinity by simply L. Therefore, we get limit of an to the power 1 by n as n tends to infinity is L. It is L because its value is L by hypothesis number 2. And hence, this proves the theorem. What about the converse of Cauchy's second theorem? It is also similar to converse of Cauchy's first theorem because Cauchy's first theorem is not true. Similarly, the converse of Cauchy's second theorem is also not true. Now, we will justify this. Consider a sequence an whose nth term is an is equals to 1 when n is odd. An is equal to 2 when n is even. That is, take n equal to 1, n is odd. A equal to 1, n equal to 1, we mean an becomes a1. That is the first term. Since 1 is odd, whose value is 1? That is, a1 will be 1. Take n equal to 2. When n is 2, we'll get second term, namely a2. This a2 is nothing but, since n is even, whose value is 2? Therefore, a2 is 2. So, first term is 1, second term is 2, then n equal to 3, odd, we get 1. Fourth term, n is 4, 4 is even, so we get 2. And hence, the sequence is 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, so on. We know that this is an oscillating sequence and oscillates finitely between 1 and 2. Let us find the limit of this. Limit of 2 to the power 1 by n as n tends to infinity is equals to 2 to the power 1 by infinity. That is, n is replaced by infinity. We know that 1 by n tends to 0. Therefore, 2 to the power 1 by infinity is 2 to the power 0. What is the value of 2 power 0? Anything power 0 is 1 except 0, because 0 to the power 0 is not defined. And hence, 2 to the power 0 is 1. That is, the nth root of 2 as n tends to infinity is 1. Similarly, the nth root of 1 as n tends to infinity is also 1. But what is the ratio of successive terms of the sequence, namely an by an minus 1? It has two values. If the value of an by an minus 1 will be 1 by 2 when n is odd, and whose value is 2 by 1 when n is even, we will check with an example. Take n equal to 3, n is odd. What answer we get? When n is odd, we must get 1 by 2. Let us check it here. When n is 3, an becomes a3. What is the value of a3? The value of a3 is nothing but the third term of the sequence. What's the value? 1. Therefore, that is the value 1 here. Now, since n is 3, what is n minus 1? N minus 1 will be a2. a2 is nothing but the second term of the sequence. What second term here? 2 is the second term. Therefore, we write 2 here. Thus, when n is odd, an by an minus 1 becomes 1 by 2. That's the one we have written here, 1 by 2. Similarly, when n is even, it becomes the reciprocal. See here, for example here, n is even, suppose 2, n is 2, then it is a2 by a1. What is a2? a2 is 2. What is a1? 1. Therefore, it is 2 by 1. Therefore, if we take the limit of the ratio of the sequence, which is not defined, that is, limit of an by an minus 1 as n tends to infinity does not exist, because it gives two values. The limit is not unique. We supposed to get 1. If it is 1, then we say the converse is true. But here the nth root of an is 1. But what about this? The limit of the ratio of successive term does not exist. Therefore, the converse of this theorem is not true.